Good morning and welcome to Thursday's edition of Ireland AM. It is the 5th of October already.
It is. Coming up today, we have got cinema, spring rolls and sex magic. Do you know what? It's a bit of a mixed bag this morning.
Well, it certainly is there. Now, Paris might have said au revoir to e-scooters, but Ireland hopes to bring in a new legislation to make them safer, and we're going to be discussing this very shortly.
And we would love to hear from you on this, whether you have one, you're a proponent of them, or you're like, no, they're a scourge. 0896 111 111. We'll be talking very shortly about that. Also, from the new Exorcist, we need another one, obviously, to the Beckhams. Mm. We're going to watch that one. And BlackBerry phones. Brian Lloyd gives us his two cents on the latest movie and streaming.
We're going to be bet into the Beckhams, aren't you?
Absolutely. I love Victoria. Bet in.
Now we're going to be meeting a witch who practices, listen to this, safe sex magic. There you go. And is about to open a witch-themed cafe in Galway.
Perfect time for it.
Telling you.
Perfect time for it.
Stay tuned for that.
Shiva is also with us this morning. Good morning, Shiva.
Morning, guys. How are we? Do you know what the best things are in Galway? A sex cafe and Connemara. What more could you ask for? We've lots more coming up today. We'll be asking, is a college degree worth it anymore, as a growing number of recruiters are looking beyond third-level qualifications, plus the perfect party pleasers in the kitchen. Cheeseburger spring rolls are on the menu today.
Yeah, never heard of them.
Cheeseburger spring rolls.
Yeah, we're wrapping them up. It's going to be good crack.
Okay.
Do you see the way you just went? Can you imagine them? It's going to be good. Derek is in the county that brought us the man of the moment from the Ryder Cup, Mr. Shane Lowry. How are things going in Offaly, Derek?
Yes, good morning. We're in some of the biggest names in the game, absolutely right. Anyway, following our trip to lovely Leash yesterday, we've landed down here in County Offaly. Now, unfortunately, it's a bit of a wet start out there this morning. Quite heavy rain crisscrossing the island, but it will break up as the day goes on. In fact, we're looking forward to some nice warm values and some nice weather into the weekend. Now, despite the bad weather here this morning, guys, the plan is to keep discovering, because we've landed here in Ireland's hidden heartlands. We're here in beautiful Birr in County Offaly. Coming up later on this morning, we're taking you on a tour of Birr Castle, the grounds. We're going to see a telescope which used to be one of the biggest telescopes in the world. We're talking about Loch Boura Bog, the Slieve Mountain, so we are bigging up awfully here this morning. And guys, did you know I'm in the coldest town in the country this morning? Birr. That's a bad joke.
My boyfriend's from Birr. I hear that about 75 million times a day. It's so much fun. I love Birr.
Do you love Birr?
I absolutely love it. It's one of the most beautiful towns I've ever been in my entire life. So many things to do, and Loch Boura is stunning.
There we go, and Derek's going to be showing us around a little later on. But now let's go up to the Virgin Media News Hub. Here's Anne O'Donnell.
Thanks, Alan. Good morning. Well, the Taoiseach is promising a cost of living package that's going to be delivered in this year's budget. And he's also said that people will be seeing the benefit of it before Christmas. Well, Leo Varadkar made those comments last night ahead of further meetings between party leaders over the coming days to hammer out the final details ahead of next Tuesday's announcement. The Taoiseach is also in Spain today, where efforts to reach agreement on the migration crisis in the bloc are now up for discussion. Well, our reporter Marie Mulcahy has the latest.
Taoiseach Leo Varadkar will be one of 47 leaders at a meeting of the European political community in Granada in Spain today. The leaders of the 27 EU states will stay back for a European Council meeting tomorrow. The Taoiseach is likely to hold a bilateral meeting with the British Prime Minister Rishi Sunak to discuss the situation in Northern Ireland. But the main topic of this summit is asylum and migration. There has been increased numbers of people crossing the Mediterranean to seek asylum in recent months, many arriving on the Italian island of Lampedusa. Yesterday in Brussels, EU ambassadors signed off on a package of extraordinary measures that countries can take in the event of being overwhelmed by asylum claims. Among the new measures is the possibility of having some asylum seekers moved to neighbouring countries or seeking financial help from others in the EU. Marie Mulcahy, Virgin Media News.
Another man is due before the courts this morning, charged in relation to the detained MV Matthew cargo vessel. Well, investigations are ongoing into that ship, where up to 157 million euros worth of cocaine was discovered, the biggest haul in the state's history. The US of Representatives is now in recess after the Speaker, Kevin McCarthy, was ousted by members of his own party. Well, the House will now need to elect a new Speaker, but there's no consensus just yet on who might be able to fill that vacancy.
The House will now reorganise and select a new Speaker. I know it's going to take some time, But I remind everyone, we have a lot of work to do, and the American people expect us to get it done. The argument we reached was about what comes next, but we had an agreement. We reached an agreement over the weekend. Funds for government, only another 40 days. We cannot and should not again be faced with an 11th hour decision on brinksmanship that threatens to shut down the government.
Well, back home, new figures indicate that there is far more problem gambling in Ireland than previously believed. That's according to the latest ESRI figures out today. Problem gambling is apparently an issue for now 1 in 30 adults. It claims that problem gamblers spend an average of more than 1,000 euros per month on their habit. And now, pilots in the US are gathering to compete in the oldest gas balloon race this weekend. That could reach from New Mexico to Canada. They'll be aloft 4 days carrying everything that they need to survive at high altitude.
Distance is the winner, not how long you're in the sky or anything. It's distance from takeoff spot. Yes, we get competitive. We're checking. After a day, you're checking to see who's left in the sky, where they're at, where they're going.
Elsewhere, the French government is to hold further meetings tomorrow to tackle the bed bug crisis in the country. Well, the French government has been forced to step in to calm an increasingly anxious nation amid headlines of the biggest infestation that the country has seen in years.
You need to be chilled to handle Irish weather. That's why Chill sponsor weather updates in Virgin Media One.
Thank you, Chair, and a very good morning. We're broadcasting here from Birr in County Offaly. Now, coming up later on this morning, we're taking you on a tour of beautiful Birr Castle here in the west of the county, the gardens as well. So that's all to come in and around 8:45. Now, we're on to the 5th of October. Shall we pull back the curtains? I think we will on your Thursday morning, because it is a pretty wet start out there this morning. You're waking up to plenty of rain, and in fact it is heavy through parts of the Midwest and across southern and southeastern regions out there this morning. But a lot of us really getting a taste of the wet stuff now in those moderate to locally fresh southwesterly winds. Now, right across today, that ongoing risk of some localised spot flooding out there today. But the good news, improving from the west, and that rain breaking up to intermittent showers then as the day goes on. But all eyes really on those temperatures out there today, because it is warming up pretty nicely. Valleys there, highs of around 15 to 18 degrees, building into that high pressure as we work our way into the weekend. And then into tonight, more showers through western and southern parts. Elsewhere, it will mainly dry out, but quite blustery in terms of those winds, and that will keep those temperatures quite mild, no lower than 13 to 16 degrees. So that's how it's shaping up here in a wet and showery Birr in County Offaly at the moment. We'll be back again live at 7:35.
You need to be chilled to handle Irish weather. That's why Chill sponsor weather updates in Virgin Media One.
Now, coming up next, I'm actually starting to scratch already. Paris is grappling a bed bug infestation. And Ireland is set to co-host the Euros in 2028.
You've clearly never picked up furniture from the side of the road, have you?
Why would you pick up furniture from the
side? You live in Australia. You just pick up furniture from the side of the road. We go behind the headlines after this. We'll talk to you very shortly. You would never. Welcome back. It's time now to take a look at this morning's papers. We'll start with the Irish Times. The headline there, Department claims Euro 2028 costs scrutinised in detail. The cost of Ireland's bid to co-host Euro 2028, previously put at between 65 million and 93 million, has been scrutinised in detail with a full cost-benefit analysis carried out. The Department of Tourism and Sport has insisted.
Stalled road projects to cost 77 lives over the next 5 years. That's the front page of the Irish Independent. Transport Minister Eamon Ryan has warned that failure to invest in new roads and improvements could result in the deaths of 77 people and 381 serious injuries over the next 5 years, according to the Transport Infrastructure Ireland.
Gardaí quit in record numbers. That is the Daily Mail today. Almost 900 fewer Gardaí are patrolling the streets compared to 3 years ago, with the force hit by a record number of resignations this year. A total of 114 officers have left the ranks since December.
The Mirror goes with, we'll get our house in order. The Taoiseach has vowed to address the vacant and derelict property scandal after it was revealed that the HSE has more than 250 empty sites on its books worth hundreds of millions of euro.
The Sun's front page, they think it's all over the place. FIFA has announced that the 2030 World Cup will be played across three continents. Europe, Africa and South America will all stage games in 2030, sparking furious backlash from football fans around the globe.
The Star leads with Gardaí's banana drama. A serving Garda allegedly harassed a female member of the force. It's alleged he tormented her with bananas after learning she has a phobia of the fruit. Garda detectives have begun an investigation.
And the Herald's front page goes with, former manager denies locked doors caused deaths. Former Stardust nightclub manager Eamon Butterley has denied that half of the 48 victims of the 1981 blaze died because three exits at the nightclub were locked when the fire broke out, preventing their escape.
The Examiner leads with, gambling a public health crisis. One in 10 adults are either problem gamblers or a report that gambling has caused multiple problems in their lives, with stark figures laying bare in the new public health emergency in Ireland.
And with more on that story, we're joined by journalist Aoife Barry. Good morning, Aoife. It's lovely to have you here. This is everywhere, one in 10. People have a problem with gambling.
Yeah, and I think maybe the last time I was on here, we were talking about gambling as well with young people and what a major issue it was with teenagers in particular. And according to this study with the ESRI, it looks like there's 10 times the number of problem gamblers in Ireland than we previously thought, which is huge. And I think it makes sense when you think about things like online gambling. It's so easy to gamble now compared to what it was 10 years ago. People can really do it without anybody knowing, which then can lead to problems and people aren't talking about it. And when it's just very, very easy at the end of a phone or if you're on your computer or whatever. So it basically says that around 3.3% of the population meet the threshold for problem gambling, which is still a very significant amount of people. And that even people with moderate gambling issues can spend around 3,000 euro, I think it is, a year.
Yeah, so those figures aren't... That's the problem, because there's a lot more people who said they had some problems with gambling, but they wouldn't be considered major problems.
Yeah.
So it's actually a vast number of people are gambling.
Yeah.
And where Professor Colin O'Gara, consultant psychiatrist with St. John of God's Hospital, said it's a public health emergency.
Such strong wording, I think. And it makes sense when you look at something like 3/4 of the population said that they engaged in any form of gambling over the last month, with 35% gambling online. So the numbers are very big in terms of the overall gambling, which then you can take from that the numbers of problem or moderate gambling are going to be big too. And that idea of talking about it, that, you know, we have seen sports stars come out as well and talk about their problems with gambling, and having people realise that it's okay to say, look, I might have an issue with this or I might have a problem with this. So this is a good study in terms of letting us know the scale of the issue, but also maybe starting that dialogue with people about the fact that gambling can be an issue at various different scales. It can be a moderate issue for people as well as serious.
Isn't it the case where years ago you'd have to go to the bookies or the casino or whatever, and now people are sitting in their own homes and losing thousands of euros, and it's sitting in their sitting room or their bedroom.
21 Paddy Power outlets are actually closing down because they're underperforming, so actual shops.
Yeah.
But gambling is huge.
And also, it's so tied in with sport. If you watch any match, you know, you'll see the ads for gambling. It's seen as part of the kind of activity that you do if you watch a match, when actually maybe people need to take a step away from that and think, actually, is this something I do need to tie in with my hobby if it can become an issue for people?
It was really interesting that they did this as an anonymous online survey. Mm. So when they did this in 2019, the problem really wasn't there because they did face-to-face chats with people. When it's anonymous, people were more open
more free
about
to
what
talk
the
about
situation is. So a lot of the questions were like, did you try to win back the money you lost? And that's leading into a gateway. You've got some people over 1,000 euro a month is what's going on gambling. And we just need to not be pointing at the, like, trying to help more and more people. 0896 111 111, because it's been found here that they're causing huge problems for households around the country, these secret gambling problems, which is what it is. We'd love to hear from you on that this morning. Now, Gardaí, we've been talking about the guards an awful lot, and we're leading up to budget day, so they're withdrawing their voluntary overtime.
Yeah, exactly. There's a dispute going on over rosters. It's been going on for a long time. It's very complicated. But basically, the Guide Representative Association members, about 11,000 of them out of about 14,000 members of the force, and they don't want a previous, like a pre-pandemic, they want a pre-pandemic roster to be brought back in, but the powers that be don't want that brought in. There's basically a dispute over the rosters. This has led to, this has been ongoing for months and months and months and months. Mm-hmm. This has basically led to them withdrawing voluntary overtime on Tuesdays. For a period of time. Next Tuesday is when you have the budget. So obviously that date was picked, presumably with, you know, potentially with that in mind. Yeah. So that means now the question is, well, what do we do about this withdrawal of voluntary overtime? So according to Michael O'Toole in the Irish Mirror today, Garda bosses are diverting almost 100 officers from rural towns and villages to help police Dublin on budget day because, I mean, we've seen recently there have been protests outside the Dáil. Things have stepped up a lot there. Very troubling protests that we've seen on some some occasions.
It's a different nature of protest.
It's a different nature of protest.
The gallows that were outside.
Those specific ones, exactly. Obviously, people have the right to protest. We have to say that, of course, as well, too. But the Gardaí, I think, will probably, and politicians will be on more high alert, perhaps, because of the budget
next
this
Tuesday,
year. So that means they have to figure out what to do. So they're basically taking the Gardaí, kind of bringing them over to work in Dublin for the day. They're not making them work overtime.
This will be their shift.
This will be their shift.
So there'll be small villages and towns with maybe no Gardaí on Tuesday, or one Gardaí.
Who will have fewer? 2,000 guards involved in, like, they were all taken.
But were they not on overtime, though?
Well, yeah, but they were taken from all around Ireland. Yeah. They couldn't just cover for overtime.
Yeah, and it says here that it's understood that the Eastern region will have to send 32 Guardian sergeants, including public order officers. So that's kind of a part of the scale of the numbers that you're talking there. So, I mean, there are obviously going to be fears about that kind of voluntary overtime ban and whether or not it will affect things on Tuesday. But I think we'll probably start hearing more stories like this about what is going to be put in place. So that diversion of working officers on that day is part of that.
In all the papers today, 114 resignations this year with Gardaí, 900 Gardaí less than they're worth 3 years ago.
They're saying it's just going to keep continuing that way.
It's really worrying. Yeah. And then if we're going to see, like yesterday the Daily Mail were reporting there's going to be a 6-foot-high steel fence around the Dáil. Like, you don't want to see something like that. It's getting to, like, January the 6th capital.
Yeah, optically that kind of thing doesn't look great. And it's really, I mean, when we saw that protest with the gallows and all that really disturbing behaviour going on, it was definitely in some ways kind of watershed moment of, okay, well, what does happen now? How do you police these sort of events and try to do it in a way where people, you know, are able to protest, but they're not able to do something that might put people in physical danger or otherwise. So it's going to be an interesting story.
We'd love to hear from you on this one, 0896 111 111, because it could be your town where the guard is gone for the day.
Yeah. Now, with this. We are getting the Euros.
Yeah.
Well, it's not official, but it looks like we're going to get it.
He's going to have the green jersey on.
But already people are going, how much is it going to cost us? Is it worth having them?
I know, the big question.
It's great for football, and it is great for Ireland to have it, because one of the quarterfinals will be here.
Yes,
but how much is it going to cost us, and are people annoyed? Are they upset?
People like Pascal Donoghue have been apparently asking the questions of, well, how much will this cost? What's the financial model for all of this? That's his job. He's allowed, you know, he's supposed
to be scrutinising that. Yeah, he's allowed to do that.
Minister for Public Expenditure, he's got to be costing all of these things very closely. The cost of it was previously put at between 65 million and 93 million. Mm-hmm. They thought first it would be 65 and then they thought it would rise to 93. So it's not an insignificant amount of money. But apparently, according to reports today, that has been scrutinised in great detail. They have looked at the financial models, they have been looking at it, and they do think that the deal is going to be rubber stamped next Tuesday. One of the big questions is they put forward the Aviva and then Casement Park in Belfast, and Casement Park basically, you know, has to be built.
It's run down. It's been knocked down and rebuilt.
Usually used by the GAA. So the question is then about the cost of that, where the money's going to come from. But the question there, I suppose, is kind of answered by the government in Britain, in the UK, putting money into the development of that. The DUP aren't very happy about this. That's one other element of that, the Casement Park element. I suppose they would have maybe certain opinions about Casement Park being a GAA.
That Windsor Park might be the place.
Maybe there might be another place that they want to go, the money to go from somewhere else, but might need to ask them a bit closer about their details on that.
They are saying that it will bring in the region of about 189 million into the economy.
But that's the thing. Where are people going to stay? More hotels.
Oh, yeah. Prices.
Like, it's all.
And whether tourists are going to to be displaced was one of the questions. Whether tourists who would normally come over but might not come over for a big match will find they can't stay that particular
Come here to me. What do you think? Would you like to have a big tournament here in Ireland? 0896 111 111. And speaking of big tournaments, what's going on in France? Are all the Irish going to be bringing home not more than onions and a beret this weekend after their match with Scotland?
This story about the bedbugs in Paris, I'm fascinated. I'm fascinated by it because it started on social media. And I always, my spidey senses always go, how true is all of this as if it's starting on social media? And in another way, I'm always like, that's a great place for stories to start because it's where we all just kind of put things that we find, right? So this started with people sharing videos and tweets about found, you know, a bedbug on the metro or, you know, in the cinema or something like that.
How'd you see a bedbug in the metro?
And they're very small. Well, people were sharing videos of what they were saying were bedbugs on, like, seats of public transport.
Oh.
And this has turned into a huge issue in Paris now. Bedbugs in big cities, that's not unusual. No. If you go to New York, stay in Airbnb. Like,
everywhere.
Everywhere. Should we all have bedbugs in our home even?
Hopefully not. I mean,
don't we all have
they're mites.
They are very small.
Mite. I mean, bedbugs different. Okay.
Yeah. Well, they are really ugly. I couldn't even watch the videos of it. But anyway, the fears are that there is an infestation, but the powers that be, you know, the Paris mayor is saying, you know, hold your horses. No, this might be a petty problem, you know, rather than something very big. Excuse my terrible French.
Beautiful.
my French teacher is like, what? but yeah, I think this is one to watch because I think if you look at this, the question is, how big an issue is it really? And how much is social media playing into it? At the same time, it's always good to know if there is an infestation on the way of bedbugs. So it's probably good to be aware of this.
And Aoife Barry has literally written the book on how things go on social media. It's amazing. A pleasure having you in as always.
Thank you
so much.
Thank
you
so much.
Cheers.
It's only a petty problem.
Petit problème.
You need to be chilled to handle Irish weather. That's why Chill sponsor weather updates in Virgin Media One.
Thank you very much, Chair. We've landed down here in Birr Castle Domain here in County Offaly. What you're seeing there on your screens right now is the Great Telescope, which was in fact built by the 3rd Earl of Ross back in 1845. The tube itself actually 70 metres long, and it was one of the largest telescopes. In fact, it was the largest telescope in the world for over 70 years, so well worth exploring if you're coming down to this neck of the woods. Now, we're getting past 7:30 here together. It's a wet start. It's intermittent here in County Offaly. Plenty of you waking up to a really wet morning out there this morning. Plenty of showers and, in fact, leaning on the heavy side to parts of the Midwest, Southern and Southeastern regions out there this morning. So hold nice and dry. Now, across today, those moderate to fresh southwesterly winds will turn blustery for a time, pushing that rain across the island. Again, will be heavy at times, brightening up through parts of the west. Mild, though, with top valleys of around 15 to 18 degrees. And into tonight, more showers to the south and into the west. Elsewhere, it will dry out with overnight lows again on the mild, again on the humid side there at around 11 to 13 degrees. So that's how we're shaping up here in Birr County Offaly at the moment. We're back again live at 8.
You need to be chilled to handle Irish weather. That's why Chill sponsor weather updates in Virgin Media One.
Staying with us now, Minister Eamon Ryan is expected to sign new legislation on e-scooters that will come into effect by the end of October.
We want to hear what you make of it. We're going to discuss it all. 0896 111 111. Joining us this morning is motoring journalist Geraldine Herbert and co-founder of Local Electric Scooters, Paddy O'Brien. Thank you both so much for being here. Talk to us about the legislation, Geraldine. What is it? What's going to happen?
Okay, so the Road Traffic Act came into law in June, but there's still regulations around e-scooters. So what we will have are two different types of regulations. One are technical regulations, and these will define what an e-scooter is in terms of being legal, and then there'll be usage regulations. So in terms of technical regulations, the weight is defined at 25 kilos. They can't have a power output of more than 400 watts, and they can only go at 20 kilometres. The wheels have to be 200 millimetres in diameter, and that's a stability issue, so that's about safety. They have to have front and rear lights, brakes, a bell. So they are the kind of things that they have to meet. So if they don't meet those requirements, then they're not. Oh, they also have to have a plate on the e-scooter saying the power output and the weight and all of that.
Right.
So if they don't meet those, they're illegal. Now, currently, e-scooters are illegal, but when if they don't meet those regulations, they're still illegal. Then there's usage regulations, right, about where they can be used on the road. And these are the big things, right? Yeah. So they cannot be used, obviously, on footpaths. They cannot be used in pedestrian areas. If they have a seat, they're not an e-scooter. You can't carry somebody on them. So it has to be just a single person. Yeah. So, and then there's a 20-kilometre speed limit, obviously, and that's really important. So that's why, so there's laws about what they are and there's laws about how they can be used.
Yep. So, Paddy, you've been selling these. How many of them meet those criteria?
It's a good chunk of them would, yeah. So there will be some that will be maybe 500 watts or will do 25 kilometres an hour or 30. Those can be, like, geographically restricted to do 20. So, like, the likes of Segway Ninebot, they're the largest manufacturer of electric scooters on the planet. They provide, like, an app where you can... It's called Scooter Hacking Utility, where you can get into the back of a scooter and tell it what region it's going to be used in. And then Segway will restrict the scooter so that it matches the regulations in that location.
But do they have the plate that's necessary now?
It can be installed, yeah.
So you'd have to go back. Yeah. So people who've bought scooters from you already, will they have to go back now and get this stuff done, Geraldine?
Well, first of all, I suppose Paddy would be better to say whether it can be done. But if it can be done, they do need to. Because as I said, if they don't meet these regulations, they continue to be illegal and can be seized.
But it's quite interesting, right? Because they're illegal right now. There's no regulations for them. They're everywhere. It's not like the guards. I don't see guards taking them off people. It's when they're on the footpath that it really gets to me, because I think that they're absolutely so handy for people getting around, like emissions-wise, traffic jams-wise, congestion. Like, it seems like they should be an answer to things, Geraldine, right?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And I mean, the thing about it is the RSA published figures yesterday and they said that 3% of the population are using them. And this was last year.
3%? So
and they're estimating about 12% will. So we need to get to grips with this. And as you say, they do. I mean, they're part of the transport solution. There's no doubt about that. But we have to ensure that older people are not scared of them on footpaths. And that's a big issue. And it's making people hesitant about using footpaths. So they need to be off them. And we need enforcement then. That is the key thing. It's one thing to regulate them. It's another thing to actually ensure that it actually works.
And Paddy, What type of people are buying these e-scooters from you?
So it's a combination of absolutely everybody, from like parents of kids who are going to college. We've got people who are working in factories where there's no bus route at 4 o'clock in the morning to get them in on time. And we've also got people like a really interesting use case is we've a few customers who've come in to get them for just to get them out and about for a walk with their husband or their wife because they've developed MS or something like that and their mobility is restricted. So there's a use case
for
everybody.
Would they be on the seated ones?
No, standing,
just stand.
Okay. So they're just standing and going really slowly. Like we a particular lady in last week like came back to tell us that the scooter that she bought recently has given her back a new lease of life that she didn't have before. And her confidence has improved as a result.
The thing is, because I do know, like we're talking about these should be a solution, but people are afraid of them. They go whizzing by. Mm. We have in our cities around the country, in Limerick and Galway, in Cork and in Dublin, the rental bikes. Mm. Great scheme, brilliant. And an awful lot of cities around the world had the rental scooters. But by a referendum in Paris, 90% of the population voted to ban them. Yeah. So are we looking at this thing that they're going to be able... Because people just will not stick by the rules, Paddy.
Yeah. In relation to Paris, Paris is an edge case and it's an interesting one because 90% of those who voted to get rid of them and 7% of the population of Paris voted. So a little over 6% of the population of Paris voted to get rid of the shared scooters and the rest of them were apathetic and just didn't vote. But there are over 200 other cities in Europe where they still have shared electric scooter schemes and shared bike schemes. What happened in Paris, you see, though, is that on day one, the regulatory body didn't take care of the situation to a great enough extent. So you had 12 operators, 40,000 scooters, not enough rules. And a good bit down the line, when the problem was already deeply set, the regulators came in, the council came in to say, we'll have 3 operators only and 12,000 scooters. But by then it was too late and the bad behaviour had set in.
Yeah, sorry, can I just make one more point? You have to be over 16 to use them as well. I'm not sure if I made that clear at the beginning. So that's a key thing, just in terms of kids using them.
If this legislation comes in then, you as a person who sells these, is it up to you then to tell people about all these rules and regulations or are we supposed to know?
You'd be surprised by how little communication we have had from anyone involved in creating regulations. So that remains to be seen. And we would quite gladly... well, we are in a position where we're directly communicating with the people who use them, and we're in a position then to advise people on how to use them and how to use them safely. We would still make recommendations to everybody that buys one that they would wear a helmet.
What would the recommendations be? A helmet?
So, a helmet. We tell people to stay off the footpaths and just to drive their scooter with due care and attention for other road users and themselves. And it's not just about you when you're on the road. And no matter what vehicle you're in, you have a duty of care to everybody that uses the space that you're in, because their safety is as paramount as your own.
To be fair, when you're buying a car, they're not telling you how to drive it when you go and get it. You know what I mean?
Sure, like,
that's your No, that's right. I was just wondering, though, who's responsible for it, then, is yourself. Sure. Yeah. On yourself,
But it's enforcement. Again, like, we're looking at an awful lot of people on the roads going in black spots. We do not see guard the cars. We do not see this. And now we're like, are we expected to have the guards on the roads taking these off people?
We also need more publicity around e-scooters. We're coming up to Christmas. People will be buying them as gifts.
Exactly,
we really need to know that the new regulations are in and what they mean.
Yeah, and they will. Coming up to Christmas, I'd say there'll be bumper sales. Yeah.
What do you make of them? E-scooters, are they a complete help or a hindrance? 0896-111-111. We would absolutely love to hear from you on this one. Geraldine Herbert, of course, our fabulous motoring journalist and editor with the Sendo, and Paddy O'Brien, co-founder of Loco Scooters. Thank you both so much for joining us.
Thank you very much. Thanks for coming in.
Lots more to come on Ireland Day.
See you in a few minutes.
Fall to Rasha Korda. Now, with Ireland being one of the most overqualified countries in Europe, we want to know what is more beneficial these days, experience or education?
We're so overqualified, guys. So overqualified. Joining us to discuss is Global Head of Learning and Development at Recruitment Consultants, Robert Walters. Louise Campbell, thank you so much for joining us this morning. We're overqualified. What exactly does that... Why are we so overqualified?
Well, if you look at the Irish population, 64% of people between the age of 18 to 24 are in some form of education. Ireland is actually the third highest in Europe in terms of participants in third level education. So there's a huge amount of Irish people in the third level piece. I think that if we recently conducted a study actually of Irish graduates, and when you look at it, it is taking Irish graduates 6 months to find work. What's really interesting, I think, is throughout their degree, 50% of them cannot find any work experience in the relevant field that they want to go into. And when they graduate, 73% of them feel as if they don't have any competitive advantage over people who do not have a degree. Rightly or wrongly.
That's scary.
Sorry, parents, if you're leaving cert students are watching. Don't bother, lads. You're grand.
It's only 3 or 4 years of your life, you know, that's all.
Exactly.
So obviously for some jobs you need qualifications such as doctors or vets or nurses, these kind of practical things. What kind of jobs are the ones that are, you know, kind of overlooking the qualifications then?
Well, a number of companies now are kind of opening up the doors and realising that there are certain jobs within their organisations that people do not need a degree for. And that is a great thing to do, because traditionally you had your, you know, people like Kellogg's, IBM, EY, Google. There was a degree qualification which was a minimum. Now that's changing, and I think that opens up the door to way more diversity in the workplace. Some people, for whatever reason, cannot afford to go to college, don't want to go to college. So there's a financial reason there. So it's opening up the doors to people from different socioeconomic backgrounds. It's also opening up the doors to people who are maybe in some way neurodiverse. So the traditional route of academia through school and through college just isn't for them, but they've got a huge skill set that they can bring to the workplace. Just because they don't want to study for 4 years doesn't mean that they don't have a huge amount that they can bring to the workplace.
Of course.
So in relation to that, I suppose, because it would have been seen you're leaving cert, like that was it, that was all you needed. And then, of course, as we moved on, it's sort of your basic degree is needed. We've got more and more people going into masters. So do you think that some places need to start going, well, we need more cop on than these incredibly educated people who have got, don't know how to work in a workplace?
Exactly. And I think when we talk to employers now, and you were mentioning it earlier, people are looking for soft skills, and it's something that is hugely missing in the young generation that's moving in. Teamwork, problem solving, communication, leadership, critical thinking, managing customer client expectations, being able to get on the phone or meet people face to face, have conversations, form relationships. No matter how many degrees you have, if you don't have the softer skills like that, it's going to be really hard to flourish in the workplace.
So do you think then from that point of view, years ago you used to do like an apprenticeship if you wanted to be with like PwC, if you wanted to be an accountant. nurses were on the job from day one.
Absolutely.
Like, they were living in halls, which was incredibly stressful. But my God, were they working? Is that the sort of thing you think you'll see companies going back to, going, after leaving, sir, come here to us, we'll do your training, but you're going to be working straight away as well?
Absolutely. And I think there has been a growth in that area. I think it should be promoted way more. Things like apprenticeships. What a brilliant way to get some real on-the-ground experience before you go into a company. Internships, specialist courses, PLCs, post-leaving cert courses, all of these things are hugely beneficial to people. So, yes, a university degree is really worthwhile. It's great. I'm not going to knock it. But it's not the only route to a successful career. Mm-hmm. There's so many other ways. And sometimes getting that practical experience brings you into a workplace, and then it's up to you. It's up to you to have that drive, determination, and all of those skills, you know, like the critical thinking, problem solving, teamwork. You know, people want to work with people like that. Yeah. No matter how many degrees you have, if you can't deal with people, nobody's going to want to work with you.
But it's great, I suppose, to see that some of those barriers then being removed from people entering the workforce. I think a lot of students, though, would point out that when you said a lot of students are struggling to find work and they don't find them for 6 months.
Yeah.
A lot of students, I think, would say a lot of these jobs are requiring them to have experience before they go in. And they're finding it hard to get their foot in the ladder because, you know, these jobs are looking for 3 years of experience in the field. Yeah. How do you go about obtaining a job when you can't get your foot in the door like that?
I know, it can be difficult. And I think that what I would say to people, if you can't get the job of your dreams, it's a really skill short market at the moment. So employers are out there looking for this range of skills that don't exist. They're looking for 10 things on an application form. If you can go and get some sort of work experience that's going to give you 3 or 4 of those, just keep on doing that. Now, that might be something as simple as working in a coffee shop, working in a bar. I mean, I often say I've had some of my best work experience working in bars, managing customers.
Yeah.
And I think it gives you that level of experience.
Yeah, it does.
So get your foot in the door somewhere and show people that you're willing to learn.
Or you have your best friend down as your CV going, yeah, work for me for 3 years. We know you do it.
0896-111-111.
Work experience versus college. We'd love to hear from you. Louise Campbell, Head of Global Learning and Development at Recruitment Consultants, Robert Walters. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Lots more coming up on Ireland AM. See you soon. Good morning. Welcome back to Ireland AM.
Now, following the testicular cancer story on Netflix's show Sex Education, we're going to be joined by a survivor and an oncologist to help you spot the signs. Very interesting, because a lot of information there.
Absolutely. And from the Beckhams to the BlackBerry, our movie man Brian Lloyd, he's back to talk us through the biggest cinema and streaming releases of the moment. That's coming up in the 9 o'clock hour.
Yes, plus we're also hearing from a woman who, listen to this, she's bringing witchcraft and sex magic to Galway.
Blood Sugar Sex Magic is a Red Hot Chili Pepper song. That's the only thing I know about it.
No, I don't think it's not the Red Chili Pepper song.
It's not the Red Hot Chili Pepper.
It is pure sex magic going to Galway. We'll tell you more a little later on.
It's like a threat.
I'm telling you, there's some sex magic happening in the kitchen this
morning. Well, let's go straight over to the two Collini. Shiva.
You took the words straight out of my mouth, Alan. Gina Daly is with us this morning, and she's marrying two of our favourite cuisines, American and Chinese. Is that right? What have you got?
So today I have cheeseburger spring rolls. So you have all the flavour of like a smashed cheeseburger, but all the crunch of a spring roll. And they're very, very tasty.
I believe. You know, I woke up this morning, I said, do you know what I want? A cheeseburger spring roll. So I'm delighted that you're making that for us this morning, Gina.
You're very welcome.
Derek's the king of the castle this morning down in Birr. How's it going, Derek?
Gurumila, Shiva. King of the castle is right. We're here in Birr in County Offaly, right across the moon. And I suppose our theme here this Thursday is to keep discovering Ireland's hidden heartlands. Gronnie, where are we at the moment, by the way?
Today we're in the Engineers Gallery. It's one of 7 galleries here in the Science Centre, and it's full of interesting artefacts that were used by, say, the 3rd and 4th Earls during their scientific discoveries. And we've also got Mary Ross's darkroom here on site, and we put in a little hologram, so we feel like she's her little ghost that goes back to tell everybody
all
about it.
In the build up to Halloween, and you're going to be telling us all about Birr Castle and the Parklands a little bit later on as well.
Yeah, I'm going to fill everybody in on what you can get up to here on a day's visit over the next few weeks.
And if it's raining, you can just hide in under a tree.
And don't worry about the hairdos on a day today.
Don't worry about the hair, don't worry about the makeup. It's all happening down here in Birr Castle. But for now, back to you guys in studio.
Absolutely. We're a little bit messy this morning, but that's okay.
Thanks, Derek.
Where have you been there?
I have been there. It's a great day out.
Lovely.
There's a cafe. You can get a cup of tea. You can get your milkery, gruely tea if you want. Don't worry about it.
You need to be chilled to handle Irish weather. That's why Chill sponsor weather updates in Virgin Media One.
Thank you, Ger. We're broadcasting live here from Birr in County Offaly. We've actually landed down here in the Science Gallery. And coming up later this hour, we're talking all things Birr Castle and the beautiful parklands that surround it, all 120 acres of it. So that's all to come in and around 8:45 this morning. Now, we're getting past 8 o'clock here together. And a lot of you waking up to a lot of rain out there this Thursday morning. That band of very heavy showers now sweeping across the island. We are looking at an ongoing risk of surface water. A little bit of spot flooding out there as well over the coming hours, and some heavy rain tracking through parts of the south and across the Midwest as well. So stay nice and dry if you're in those neck of the woods. Now, right across the day, in fact, that rain easing back to scattered showers. So we're going to see that improving picture as we edge our way across the day, brighter then through parts of the west. The westerly winds will be blustery at times as well, so do be mindful of that if you're in coastal regions. Top values, though, are on the up. It will be quite a mild day out there today, in around 15 to 18 degrees. Into tonight then, southern and western showers. Elsewhere, it is holding steady. And again, quite a mild night in store with overnight lows there. No lower than 11 to 14 degrees. So that's how it's shaping up here in Birr Castle, County Offaly. At the moment, we're back again live from the Wall Gardens. 35.
You need to be chilled to handle Irish weather. That's why Chill sponsor weather updates in Virgin Media One.
It's time now to take a look at this morning's paper, starting with the Irish Times. Its headline: Department claims Euro 2028 costs scrutinised in detail. The cost of Ireland's bid to co-host Euro 2028, it was previously put at between 65 million and 93 million. It has been scrutinised in great detail with a full cost-benefit analysis carried out. The Department of Tourism and Sport has insisted.
Stalled road projects to cost 77 lives over the next 5 years. That's the front page of the Irish Independent. Transport Minister Eamon Ryan has been warned that failure to invest in new roads and improvements could result in the deaths of 77 people and 381 serious injuries over the next 5 years, according to the Transport Infrastructure Ireland.
Gardaí quit in record numbers. That's the front page of the Daily Mail. Almost 900 fewer Gardaí are patrolling the streets compared with 3 years ago, with the force hit by a record number of resignations this year. A total of 114 officers have left the ranks since December.
The Mirror goes with "We'll get our house in order." The Taoiseach has vowed to address the vacant and derelict property scandal after it was revealed that the HSE has more than 250 empty sites on its book and on its books, and it's worth hundreds of millions of euro.
The Sun leads with "They think it's all over the place." FIFA has announced that the 2030 World Cup will be played across three continents, Europe, Africa and South America, with all stage games in 2030. It sparked apparently furious backlash from football fans around the globe.
The Star leads with "Garda banana drama." A serving Gardaí allegedly harassed a female member of the force. It's alleged she tormented her with bananas after learning she has a phobia of the fruit. Garda detectives have begun a criminal investigation into the complaint.
The Herald goes with "Former manager denies locked doors caused deaths." Former Stardust nightclub manager Eamon Butterley has denied that half of the 48 victims of the 1981 blaze died because three exits at the nightclub were locked when the fire broke out, preventing their escape.
And the Examiner leads with "Gambling a public health crisis." 1 in 10 adults are either problem gamblers or report that gambling has caused multiple problems in their lives, with stark figures laying bare the new public health emergency in Ireland.
Now, guys, got lots of text coming in. I've scooted in.
Move up beside us. We were talking about e-scooters and this new legislation that's going to come in. Eamon Ryan is expected to bring in legislation about e-scooters, and everybody across the country has seen people on e-scooters. They're becoming so popular. Would you get one?
I think that they're great in terms of environmental. They're also great for accessibility for people who maybe might not have the mobility for bikes. But I haven't personally. I use a lot of public transport. So
would you get one, Warren? Just to like, I never actually thought for myself, would I get one just to like the convenience of it, to instead of getting into the car to go small short journeys.
Yeah, I kind of live in and around town, so I just walk everywhere.
Oh, yeah. What about you?
It's grand.
No, I don't. That's what I'm saying. I don't think I've ever even thought of getting
it. Will it be under the Christmas tree for you this year?
Well, maybe if it
I can
got
see him
there.
With it'll be a plush throne. It'll be one of those big ones he'll be driving around.
Velvet seat.
Well, you're not allowed to have a seat because that doesn't come under
But that could be you get one of the mobility scooters. Oh, you'd love one of those.
I'm not that old.
Bernie
dear.
Says these e-scooter laws, if Tommy was here, you'd open it up. These e-scooter laws all sound good, but how will they be enforced? The scooters are lethal on the road and the fatalities involving them are heartbreaking. A local dad brings his two kids home from school on them in our area. You will not be allowed to do that. It will only be one person per scooter. That's the thing, it is about enforcement, but you are allowed, they'll be treated like they are a bike, but I suppose a bike is allowed to go more than 20 kilometres an hour, but 20 kilometres an hour is the limit.
Anthony texts in, e-scooters should be required to have insurance. If they're going to be used in the roads, then it's only fair. Also, if an e-scooter crashes into a car, how do we know who pays for the damage if they have no insurance?
Well, that happens with a bike. So if you're on a bike, if you're on your bike and you crashed into a car...
See, this is the issue, because... Bikes can go quicker. Like we were talking to Geraldine Herbert, she was like, bikes in and around even like a Dublin bike, which are quite clunky, or the Limerick bikes or Cork bikes, they can go up to 30 kilometres an hour if they get a bit of speed on them. So these are only meant to go 20 kilometres an hour. So they're being treated like bikes are treated.
And Mela said, you were saying, they're great for the environment, they're cost effective and they've cut down on my daily commute. I'm in favour of bringing in legislation to make them safer, but e-scooters have changed my life.
See,
well, there you go, Mel.
Yeah, and I suppose it's kind of a choice between bringing in the legislation or banning them all together. Like, there's no middle ground there, is there?
And they have to do something about it. Yeah. We don't have time to get through all your bed bugs texts, but they're so good. I just very quickly want to say hi to Kate. I had bed bugs on my J1 in New York. My mother made me sleep in the shed when I came back. Hello to Kate's mother. My God. Send in your bed bug text.
I hope she got a sleeping bag.
Welcome back from New York. There's your room.
This is in relation to the bed bug infestation apparently happening in France during the World Cup. 0896-111-111 Kate. How was the shed?
That might have been better than the accommodation on the J1, though, in fairness.
Might have been, to be perfectly fair, the shed. Yeah. We'll be back with you in Ireland Day very shortly. Welcome back to Ireland AM. Now, before we go any further, we have... It's a small spoiler alert for anyone who's watching the new series of Sex Education on Netflix. It happens in episode 2. It's just a small one.
In episode 2, one of the characters, Jackson, gets a bit of a shock. Let's take a look.
Hey, do you want to stay? We could get to know each other, huh? A bit.
I meant it when I said I want this to be casual.
Yeah.
I'm not doing relationships right now. It's probably nothing, but I felt something in your ball. I think you might have a lump. You might want to get it checked out. Huh?
There you
go. She's very vigilant. Right here going, oh my God. But seriously, testicular cancer is one of the most common cancers found in men aged between 15 and 34.
Wow.
It is so young. We're joined by survivor David Caulfield and oncologist Professor Ray McDermott to discuss this further. You were looking at that going, she's fair play to her.
She
knew what she was looking for, which has to be, you know, you wouldn't even think about it sometimes. Because let's talk about you, David.
Yes.
You are a survivor of testicular cancer.
Do you know what? In 2020, if the year wasn't bad enough, we were all kind of coming back to life and going out and meeting people. And I had a moment. I was in bed as well, but I was on my own. I didn't have some woman coming around to tell me what I had a lump.
That's what
on.
We like to do, apparently. Yeah.
But so I found the lump one night in bed, and I was instantly, obviously, like most people would be, a little bit bereft of what might come from this. So the next day I was kind of having a conversation, and I think in the dark of night you kind of think of the worst. Mm. The next morning you have a little bit more optimism, and I had attempted to ignore it, but I spoke to a friend and she was like, no, you need to deal with this. It's very important. And actually only, I think, a couple of months earlier had she read Lance Armstrong's book, who had double testicular cancer. So she was very aware of the speed in which something like this cancer can act. So she said, don't mess about. So I found a doctor who had a cancellation that day.
Oh, wow.
And
okay.
They immediately got me in and we started the process.
And can I ask you, would you regularly check for this or was it just a one-off?
Do you know what? I would say, like, looking back now, I always kind of, I'm never really sure about the answer to that question. But what I do know is that I know my body. And I think that's the most important thing.
Did you feel unwell then?
No.
Oh, right.
I mean, like many people, the only thing we could do in 2020 to get outside was exercise. Mm. So I was actually, I would say I was the healthiest I've ever been in my life because I was running and walking daily. I was doing yoga. I was doing online courses. Like, I was in the best place I could have possibly been. Went to the School of Life in 2020. But yeah, so I was fit, healthy and well.
And you were what age?
I was 33 at the
33
time.
33 years old. So from that night when you felt the lump.
Yeah.
To having your lumpectomy and everything and being cancer-free, how long was that?
So the orchidectomy happened 6 weeks after I found the lump.
Wow.
6 weeks?
Yeah, so
that's
within
very
6 weeks. Very quick. Mm. It's almost like it's done before you know. Like it's quite a roller coaster of a ride. Like it gets a little bit intense because obviously you're healthy and well and you can go to the doctor and you can you don't have to tell everybody that. But as soon as you have a surgery. I think that the surgery for me was the scariest bit.
I can just imagine.
Yeah, I can imagine.
Of course it is.
And like, Ray, when we're talking about this, like, I was taken aback by the age group there that it's the biggest cancer in Ireland in men for those ages. Like, I'm 16 up.
But it's let's not get carried away. It's not that common. It's just that in that age group, cancer isn't very common, thankfully, because obviously it's very traumatic. But it is something to be very aware of because it's entirely curable. Even if you present at a late stage, which we don't want, and the whole point of today is to get people to go early.
Yes.
Even if you present at a late stage, we can still, the 90% plus of the time, cure it. But we want people, like David did, to be aware of their bodies, to go to check themselves and to go early rather than delay.
See, I see something like this and I will check myself now.
Yeah.
And then I mightn't do it for months or, like, you just... Is it just maybe something like if you're having a shower, just do it or whatever?
Yeah, I mean,
like
I think basically the recommendation is once a month after a shower because if you're cold or you know if you've had a fright, you know you won't be able to feel your testicles
How
properly.
Often are you
as
getting
well.
Frightened? Right.
Because they run away very quickly.
I can imagine. I don't know. I'm not an expert. But we've got a demonstration here because we found this on the internet. We're going to get you to do it for us, Ray, because we have Breast Cancer Awareness Month in October and we're always doing it and there's always kind of, we always have boobs around here, you know, fake boobs, and we're told how to check. But we don't talk about testicular cancer in such a way. So we found this on the internet and it's, if we can show that, because we're doing this genuinely.
Okay,
so this
on.
Is it. They used conkers, right?
Yeah.
To show these sorts of things. So we've gotten, it was suggested that we get one of the pool balls from up in the other building. We thought maybe we don't want to scare people.
Don't be giving men an inferiority complex.
So let's not, exactly. We didn't want to do that. So we have just put a couple of things inside in this balloon, right?
Thank
Is that okay?
Lovely.
So can you show us
what
men should
be doing? So basically, the first principle, warm skin, that makes it easier to feel your testicles, right?
Okay.
Second thing is, there is a little tube that comes out of the back of your testicle that can be very tender. That's what takes the sperm away from your testicle. So it's normal.
So when you're feeling that, you feel, oh, that's a bit lumpy there.
It feels a little bit like a worm that's going away from you. Nothing to worry about. Can be tender. Don't worry about it.
Yeah.
So what you're looking for is a change in the overall size, or you're also looking for a lump. I don't know which you felt.
I felt a lump. So a lump that doesn't move, that's in the middle of the...
So, what kind of a lump was it? Can I ask you, was it like the size of a pea? Was it hard? Was it soft?
Yeah, I think the best way I described it to many people was like if you had like a normal size grape and you kind of pressed lightly on it, there was like a stone inside it. That's what it felt like. Yeah. It was very obviously a lump that I could feel from either side of the testicle. And it wasn't moving. So, like, the bag of worms that you feel, like, you talk about, that moves.
Okay.
Or if you've got a cyst,
this was very obvious then.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So, basically, what you're looking for, so the normal testicle is kind of rugby ball shaped, probably a little bigger than that. You're looking for a change in either the overall size, because sometimes you don't feel a lump, you just notice that it's changed in size.
Okay.
And it's normal for men to have testicles that are different size,
yeah,
by the way.
Yeah.
You're looking for changes, not for the absolute, you know, what it's always,
yeah,
been. So it can either be a lump, like David described, or it can be an overall change in size. Pain is not generally a feature of testicular cancer. It can be, but it's not generally a feature. So don't be reassured if you say that doesn't, the jurors hurt.
No, not
doesn't
at
tend
all.
To be a, doesn't okay. tend to be a feature. So what you do to go back to it, you go into the shower, warm skin, take your testicle one at a time between your fingers and thumb, and just gently feel over it,
yeah,
between the two, looking for any of those changes that we described, either an overall change in the size or a discrete lump.
Okay.
Discrete. Now, to be honest, the lump is probably going to be, you know, about a centimetre before you can feel it. So very small lumps the size of a pea, I'm not sure.
They don't be squeezing.
You
know,
don't be squeezing the light.
You don't need to be sensitive. Right.
You know, they're, yeah, sensitive. You don't, yeah, be trying to kill yourself. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. So you're giving some advice to girls.
Yeah.
And Ray,
just
in relation to this, sorry, because it would be fertility would be
that, yeah,
an issue, right? Because this is your sperm count. It is,
yeah, yeah,
you know, one of your testicles.
Yeah.
So what's the situation there?
So basically, you have two testicles, obviously, and for the vast majority of people, there's sufficient sperm in the other testicle, even if you have to have an orchidectomy like David did. The standard treatment is not take out the part with the lump on it, it's take out the testicle. So you have the other testicle. It doesn't go from one testicle to the other. So cancer doesn't spread from one testicle to the other. So,
but could it?
No, it doesn't.
Oh, it doesn't?
So it doesn't. So basically, you still have the other testicle, and generally, for most people, that's going to be fine. Occasionally, and David, you can talk about this, we can do sperm banking if people need,
yeah,
to.
So I was asked at the time, just before surgery, because they never know where they're going to have to go with the process. So if you have to undergo chemotherapy, radiotherapy, that's going to affect your fertility or your sperm. But also, like any of our organs that we have two of, one is stronger than the other. So they don't know which one is producing the most sperm or the most active sperm until they take the one,
okay,
that's away. So I had no intention of having children or anything, but suddenly when this option gets handed to you on a plate, you reconsider a lot of things and you think, oh, okay, in 10 years' time, maybe I'll be in a different position,
yeah,
and I'd like to have the option. So I have, yeah, I have some sperm in a bank.
Bank frozen, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Do they do that for you, the HSE here?
Yeah, that's available to any patient.
That is available.
And it's always discussed with people, yeah.
When you're doing,
yeah,
it.
And you know, some women choose to have breast reconstruction, yeah, surgery or whatever. Is that,
yeah,
a thing that happens?
Yeah, so you can put in, you know, a replacement testicle. They're not great. The one thing I've always been not very impressed with in terms of their consistency, and they're kind of hard.
I never really wanted to get one.
Can I just ask
you? If they took it out and put it in again,
can I ask you a personal question? Do you feel any different?
No. I tell you what I did do. After I had my testicle removed, I went on a journey to kind of learn to love my body and what it does for me.
Right.
And relearn, actually, you know, like, there's only one down there. And then after a year, they come back and they say, do you want another one in? I'm like, no, I don't want to go under the knife for no reason. I'm used to this.
Yeah.
This is me. This is who I am.
Yeah.
I've got a battle scar. You know, it's very faint now, but that's who I am. And I don't,
yeah,
really want to have to have anything fake in my body.
It's not very visible.
Yeah. No,
well,
yeah.
This is,
yeah,
true.
To be fair.
Yeah. Yeah. We're not getting it out on telly.
I suppose.
No.
The, yeah,
if
we're not getting it out on telly.
It was for health purposes.
Yes, exactly.
And I suppose the message is keep checking yourself once a month after a shower, after a hot shower,
yeah,
and you will find
and
it early. And that's
just
the,
say
that's
one
it.
More thing. You asked David, did he feel unwell? You're not going to feel unwell.
Okay.
You're not going to.
With testicular cancer.
With testicular cancer, unless it's very advanced, and it's not, generally speaking, you're not going to feel unwell. Mm. So don't be kidded by that. Don't,
yeah,
be fooled.
And if
just
you're worried, talk to somebody.
Exactly.
Because everybody,
yeah,
takes you seriously.
Go to your doctor. It's easy test. Get an ultrasound, because that's the test.
And that's the thing.
It's non-invasive. Just...
yeah,
probe on your tech.
Yeah.
There's more information on cancer.ie should you need to go there. And I really do appreciate kind of that, because we never do, like, how do you examine,
yeah,
yourself for that? Thank,
yeah,
you so much.
You're
for
welcome.
Coming in. David Coverley, who is a cancer survivor. Thank you so, so, so much. And Professor Ray McDermott, who is a consultant medical oncologist. Thank you both. So
thank
much
you
for
both.
Being with
very
us today.
Interesting.
Thank
Thanks
you.
For coming in.
Thanks.
You need to be chilled to handle Irish weather. That's why Chill sponsor weather updates in Virgin Media One.
Ger, take a look at what's on your screen there. This is the Treehouse Playground. Absolutely incredible. We're on our way towards the Wall Garden here in Birr Castle and Domain here in County Offaly. We're talking about the parklands, the grounds itself, and the history behind it all, as well as talking all things Offaly at 8.45. So that's all coming your way in another wee while. Now, quick look at weather slipping past 8.30, and the heavens have opened here in the Hidden Heartlands at the moment. I have to say it is a pretty wet start, but we don't mind that because it is going to brighten up through parts of the west. So a little bit of good news as we edge our way across your morning, bearing in mind those winds will strengthen as well from the southwest. Now, right across the day, it is that mixture of sunshine and scattered showers where those showers do fall, leaning on the slightly heavier side as that system clears out into the east. So we could be looking at an ongoing risk of spot flooding and surface water out there today. Top valleys on the up, though, quite mild at around 14 to 18 degrees. And into tonight, then, mainly dry and settled across eastern areas. Showers then to parts of the west in across southern regions with overnight lows. Again, holding on the mild and humid side there at around 11 to 13 degrees. So that's how it's shaping up for now. We'll head down to the Wall Garden and we'll catch again back live here from Birr Offaly, 8.45.
You need to be chilled to handle Irish weather. That's why Chill sponsor weather updates in Virgin Media One.
Perfect coffee every time. Tassimo sponsors cookery on Ireland AM.
You're very welcome back. Agus Gur Mágat, as Fonaclin Ireland AM. Now, with us now, we have Gina Daly, a.k.a. The Daily Dish on Instagram, to give her twist on the classic spring roll.
Yeah, Gina, what have you... This is delicious, I have to say. I'm milling it already.
I'm glad you like it. So what we're doing is cheeseburger spring rolls. So you have all the flavour of a cheeseburger, but all the crunch of a spring roll. So it's just something a little bit different. You can have it as a main meal, or you can make small ones as an appetizer. And it's really, really easy to make. I don't make my own pastry, which Alan has.
Alan did. You called her out for that already, didn't you?
No, but I love that you don't, because most people would be at home going, oh God, I have to do all that.
No, just shop-bought one. I mean, anything for convenience and, you know, it's grand, and they taste lovely. So what we're going to start with is hot pan, a little bit of oil, and I've just kind of part cooked mince just for the sake of the telly, because we have to have quick
Gina,
time
what
today.
What do you do? Like, if people, I always call this mince in the pan, but it can be quite bland. So would you do this at home, even just the mince in the pan and not doing the spring roll thing?
Yeah, like...
What would you put in it? What livens it up a bit?
Well, mince to me is just kind of icky. So the best thing to do, like, for say, for example, for the cheeseburger ones, what I always do to season them is I use a little bit of soy sauce.
Oh, soy sauce, OK.
So it gives it a nice bit of saltiness.
Yeah.
I put in some garlic powder. You can
use
real
garlic.
That
in the house. I have that. I have both of them.
A bit of Worcester sauce.
Don't have that.
that's nice.
You don't, necessarily need it, but... it just gives it, that, I like to say that tang kind of to mince, because if you have mince on its own, it's you'd never eat it again. And what I'm going to do then is I throw in a few onions. So you're going to have that kind of burgery taste with the onions. I love a raw onion in it. A few tomatoes.
All chopped up.
All chopped up.
Yeah.
I can't, me pan. But it's all right. It's okay. It's all cooked. And then what I'm going to do is I'm just going to put a little bit of mustard.
Okay, so,
you're
going to
get the cheeseburger
taste. What you would put on top of your burger is going in now.
Okay. In now.
But tomato sauce.
A little bit of ketchup. Excuse me. And what you don't have to do then is worry about, like, layering burgers up. I find if you're making burgers at home, it can be quite messy. When you're biting into them, they fall apart. They're all over your face.
Yeah, your hands get very messy.
Sorry about this now.
Here, Gina, give me that now. Oh, there you have it.
So a bit of ketchup, and then you're just going to mix it all in.
Okay.
And once...
And is that it?
That's literally it. So if you were making, say, a cottage pie, or you're doing...
I was going to say that could go into
lasagna,
that now,
or you're doing spaghetti bolognese, anything like that, this is how I would season my mince. Now, minus the mustard, but I would use the soy, I'd use all the bits and pieces in it.
Would you still do the ketchup?
Yeah.
Really?
Ketchup. Okay. And if I'm making burgers, say burger patties, I'll mix it in, marinate it all into a bowl first, and kind of leave it sitting for a while, let the mince absorb it, and it's really, really tasty. So the next part. So now you can add in salt, you can add in pepper. Yeah. The soy gives it a nice bit of saltiness, so okay. you don't necessarily need it. And then the ingredient that you're going to put in is your cheese as well. So you're going to grate that in on top. So what cheese does then to your mince is going to bind it all together and get it kind of nice and saucy.
Oh, so it's all melted.
Yeah,
it's
really
any particular type of cheese?
So this is cheddar.
All right.
This is a Dublin cheddar.
Yeah.
But if you like kind of American cheese, that works really, really well too. Usually what I do is, just because I'm on the telly today, I didn't want to bring my plastic cheese with me. They're in that one. So you just throw them in, throw a bit of water, melt it all up, and you can actually do a cheese dipping sauce at the side. So like all a cheese right. hack for a sauce, if you like nachos.
Yeah.
Three slices of cheese, bit of water.
See the way you have that now. I would get a fork and I would mill that.
Yeah. Before it even touches the pastry.
If you've got nachos, like dig into it. So now this is the tricky bit.
Okay.
But it's still easy. So what you're going to do is you're going to get some shop bought puff paste or phyllo pastry. Okay.
Yeah.
Now you can buy spring roll wrappers, but it's the same kind of idea.
Yeah. Is it thin enough?
Oh yeah.
The spring rolls would be quite thin, wouldn't they? The pastry.
So you can
look
see.
At that. Yeah, they're quite thin.
Now, it's very delicate. It can be a bit tricky doing this bit, but it's easy enough. So you're just going to put kind of as much as you want, really.
Like you can make them make big or small,
Exactly. So we're just going to put...
It's probably easier to make a couple of big ones, isn't it?
They are. And you know what? You get fuller on them and they're nicer. Like the little ones are lovely for thrown in the middle of a table before dinner.
Yes.
So what you're going to do is get more cheese. And
always, always more cheese.
Cheese is
there you go.
So this is loads of layers, like myself.
Lovely.
So you're going to, this is how you're going to wrap it. So you're going to bring this part over, bring the sides in. Now, it doesn't have to be perfect.
No.
You're gonna, you know, they break up anyway. It's so
now,
delicate.
Do you put this into the oven or do you deep fry it?
So
or
you can do it three ways. My air fryer does everything. So that's...
That's it there.
That's one.
Okay.
And in the air fryer, you're going to spray them with a bit of oil because you're putting phyllo pastry in, it can kind of be powdery.
Yeah.
So you and want it to have that crunch.
If you wanted to deep fry them, that's tight enough. Nothing's going to fall apart or anything, though?
No, they might burst a little bit. But if you feel that the pastry is too thin, use two layers. It's absolutely
okay.
fine.
Okay, and in the oven, perfect as well. What,
perfect.
20 minutes or so?
About 20, 25 Five. Minutes, a little spray of oil.
And you have them all here. They look beautiful.
Yeah. Yes. So what you do then is you make yourself a little dipping sauce. So literally...
The sauce is amazing.
You're going to get some mayo.
So good.
A little bit. So if you have gherkins, you can chop them up.
Yeah.
Or...
Okay.
Pop that
absolutely.
In.
You know what? I'm going to have another one. I've eaten mine already. Gina, absolutely delicious. Thank you so
much.
They are gorgeous, aren't
so
they?
Good.
Really good. Mm. Now, after the break, Derek's out and about in Birr.
Yeah, stay with us.
Perfect coffee every time. Tassimo sponsors Cookery on Ireland AM.
Thanks very much for staying with us. Now, Derek is in Offaly today, exploring one of Ireland's hidden heartlands.
He certainly is. Derek, how's it going down there this morning?
Well, guys, the rain, it is pouring out of the heavens here, isn't it, Gráinne? Yeah.
Oh, it's great.
New hairdo, new hairdo.
There's mascara coming down her face, but we don't mind that because it's all about keep discovering Ireland's hidden heartlands here this morning. And guys, back at base, do you know how many counties are here in the hidden heartlands themselves? Any guesses?
Seven. Seven.
You know, I know, it's a tricky one. So what we've got is we've got a barcode up on air at the moment and we want viewers to scan that barcode and give a guess. We have two options there on it and we'll reveal it later on this morning at 9.35. Yeah, it's 9 or 11, 9 or 11. Give a guess there, scan it live on air. Anyway, Gráinne O'Malley, you're very welcome down here and it's great to be here in Birr Castle.
Yeah, welcome back again, Derek. You're almost a local now.
I'm almost a local, absolutely.
Like Offaly now is in your top five places to visit.
It's in my
Ireland.
DNA. Now tell us about the castle itself, the history of it.
Okay, well, the Parsons moved to Birr in July 1620 and they've been here for over 400 years. And the current 7th Earl and Countess of Ross, like Brendan and Alison, still live in the castle. And like Lady Ross often says, there's 99 rooms in the castle. Like, so I said, you never count them. So, and thank God I'm not hoovering it. That's all I think.
You'd be cleaning it all day, wouldn't
all
you?
All day, you'd never get back to the start again. But so the history, the family have been here, as I said, over many generations. And there's lots of fascinating stories. Every tree, every artifact you look at on site has a really important story, and they've been pioneers when it comes to science, not just one of them, multi generations. So the castle itself, which is open that during the summer, it's still very much a family home. And as I say, it's like the biggest doll's house you were ever in.
I know. I was down here last year. I came on a week's holidays to Offaly and I spent 2 days here in Birr, not just a staycation, but like you can make a week's holidays here in Offaly itself. But the family, they came out and met me. They were great fun and took us on that tour of a couple of the rooms.
Yeah, we usually open about 5 rooms during the summer months. But like Lauren and Lady Ross move and use every room in the house. Like I went in one day and she, the grandchildren, painting, you know, with the glass and the paint palette, and they're sitting on the cream Chippendale couch. And I'm like, oh, that's something we're afraid to touch. And the kids are there painting away in the castle.
And the beautiful grandfather clock in the hall as well.
Oh, yeah, there's a ghost stories behind that one. It had to be blessed and all sorts of stuff to stop it from falling over and things like that. Nobody wanted it in their home.
The parklands itself, we have 120 acres of parklands here too.
Yeah, we've over 10 kilometres of walks, 2 rivers and a lake, and the place is plumbed like your kitchen sink, so we can raise the level of the lake and lower the level of the lake. I mean, we bring engineers in here to do various jobs, and they're like fascinated, going, what do you mean you can turn off the river, or what do you mean you can raise up the height of the lake?
It's the Camcor River that runs through here.
The Camcor and the Brosna, and then they meet down the far end of the domain.
There is a big focus on biodiversity here in the state, as well as sustainability too.
Yeah, well, we have like over 5,000 species of plants collected from all over the world by the 5th, 6th and 7th Earls of Ross. But we've no lighting in the domain, so at nighttime it's very rich in terms of biodiversity. You know, we've red squirrels, we've got pine martens, we've managed to capture the otters on camera. You know, they're so elusive.
And kingfisher as well. I remember I spotted a kingfisher here the last time. Now, let's move on to the science part, because this is a centre of science really as well.
Yeah, well, in 1845, the 3rd Earl of Ross built the biggest telescope. He was the first man in the world to see the furthest into space. And as I say to the kids when they come here on school trips, I said, imagine this was all done before electricity, you know. And he was up there in the platform with his little red lantern, which was lit by a candle, and drew his discoveries, like with charcoal on paper. And they're just so similar to the big images that have been taken by the Hubble telescope, a more modern telescope.
And that telescope itself, it was the largest telescope in the world for over 70 years.
Yeah, but the word is, right, that the 3rd Earl had built a 3-foot telescope and he walked into the castle and he says, Mary, it's not big enough. So we need to go bigger. And they went bigger. So they made the mirror and everything on site. The annealing ovens are still out the back of the castle and they just look like big peat ovens. They're actually pretty cool. Someday I'll fire them up and have a few pepperoni.
The science galleries as well. I mean, there's so much to see and so much to do up there as well too.
Yeah, we've 7 science galleries and they're full of really rare artifacts. You know, it's only when you start looking at their values and what they were used for, you think, oh my God, this has been here for 250, 300 years. They're all the instruments that were used in astronomy. And then we've got the lunar heat machine, which predicted the ambient temperature in the moon 70 years before Neil Armstrong landed. So there's a letter up there from Neil Armstrong to, you know, give credit to the 4th Earl on his discoveries.
Also, in fact, this used to be a weather station here in Birr and Offaly, here in the grounds of the castle.
I mean, half 5 this morning, blow drying the hair now. It was a complete waste of time. So, yeah, there was a weather station here on the Keep Gate and the weather was sent up to Glasnevin. But, like, we want a really cool, well, I think it's a cool fact, that the original barrel on the telescope is 52 feet long. And that was built by Hook and Guinness way back. And there's photographs of it taken out through the gates in James's, St. James's Gates, and brought down by barge to Banagher, and then, you know, pony and trap or cart over here to Birr. It's actually
so much to see
amazing.
And to do. Where can people find out more online, by the way?
Birrcastle.com. Visit Birrcastle.com, and then all our social media, Facebook and Twitter and Instagram, is Birrcastle.
All right, we're going to keep discovering Ireland's hidden heartlands here in County Offaly. We have more from the fateful county into the next hour, but for now, we're going to huddle up here like penguins. Back to you in studio. Get answering as well. Get scanning.
I know. Science Museum. They're going to invent an umbrella for him.
Yes. Has he heard of the word umbrellas?
He's we don't know. He's going to get a cold, Derek. He's going to get a cold.
Awfully wet.
Oh my God.
There we go.
I'll just go.
People of Offaly, she did it for you this morning. Thank you, Derek. We'll be back with you in just a little while. There's lots more to come on Ireland AM. Stay with us.
We'll be right back.
Welcome back to Ireland AM. Sex magic and super movies are on the agenda this hour. Here is what is coming up. Please explain to me, Alan.
Yes, we're going to be talking myths and Mother Goddess with a Galway-based witch who's opening a witch-themed cafe. And it's sort of sex magic as well, but is there...
I've never heard... Of course, there's magic about everything.
Look at Brian Lloyd looking at us going, sex magic? I'm staying around for that.
You can tell us more about it. We've also got the latest... Flicks and Picks. Shiva is with Brian Lloyd, whose ears have picked up.
I tell you, he's our sex god here every week.
Yes, well, funny you say
that.
Funny you say that, guys, because there's a documentary out today about arguably one of the sexiest men in history. But no, I'm not talking about Brian Lloyd. Brian, what can we expect from the David Beckham documentary?
I'm going red. So, yeah, it's basically a very kind of candid but a little bit controlled look at the life of the Beckhams. Follows, you know, his football career and then, you know, going from Manchester United all the way over to LA Galaxy, and then the kind of the tabloid pressure that he experienced as well. So there's a lot in it, yeah. Okay. Over four episodes.
Okay, looking forward to hearing about that then. We're going to shoot over to Derek, who is having a brilliant time in Offaly this morning. How's it going, Derek?
Shiva, we're on the lookout for the Galway sex witch. Is she here, Gráinne?
Yeah, she's probably in a pit stop on the way back to Galway.
Come here, there's lots happening here in Birr over the coming weeks as well, isn't there?
Yeah, we've the offline film festival starting next week. Jim Sheridan's doing the opening night, and then we've lots of activities here on site with trails and loads of things going on over Halloween.
Oh, okay, we'll have more on that in and around 9:35. But for now, where's that Galway sex witch? I don't know, she'll be here back to the studio.
She'll be here in a few minutes.
You need to be chilled to handle Irish weather. That's why Chill sponsor weather updates in Virgin Media One.
Thank you very much, Ger. We're live here from Birr Castle Domain here in County Offaly, right across the Moray. Now, coming up later this hour, we're sticking with the fateful county. We're talking all things Lochbuir, Discovery Park and the beautiful Slievebloom Mountains. So that's all to come at 9:35. Now, quick look at weather and a bit of a breather from the rain here in Offaly at the moment. But a lot of you dealing with a lot of heavy rain out there now at the moment, pushing very slowly across the island as that system tracks eastward. So we're seeing a bit of a breather through parts of Galway, Mayo, Clare, Limerick, Cork and Kerry as we speak, but elsewhere plenty of heavy rain, so stay nice and dry and keep the rain gear handy. Now, right across the day, that southwesterly airflow will pick up pace. It will be strong and blustery at times, so once again it is that mixture of brighter spells with plenty of rain out there today. We could be looking at surface water and spot flooding too in some spots, but temperatures are on the up. It really is the only plus we can pull out of this Thursday. Values there in and around 14 to 18 degrees, and they are on the up with warm weather guaranteed into the weekend. And finally then, tonight showers through western and southern parts. Elsewhere, that's a lot more settled as those winds ease back and take their foot off the pedal as we work our way into your Friday morning, with overnight lows again on the mild and humid side there at 10 to 14 degrees. So that's how it's shaping up here in Offaly at the moment. We're down in Birr. We'll be back again live 9:35.
You need to be chilled to handle Irish weather. That's why Chill sponsor weather updates in Virgin Media One.
Now, welcome back to the show. We've been chatting about an awful lot of things on the show today. And one of the stories was the apparent scourge of bedbugs that are in France at the moment. Bedbugs. They're not handling this very well.
No, we just hate them. Because they're going to show us a graphic of what a bedbug would actually looks like. So let's have a look, and we go, there was hundreds of, so there'd be all these in your bed.
Oh, God. So it's like a wood lice kind of thing.
It's like an earwig, yeah.
It's the size of an earwig, though. No,
no,
I thought they were
smaller.
Tiny.
They're
yeah.
smaller. They're smaller. Frank says, once had to throw out all the mattresses in the house when I had a massive bedbug infestation.
Ooh.
We only moved in the year before, so all the mattresses were brand new. Such a waste.
Oh,
nothing you can do with it. That wasn't Ireland, was it? We don't have them, do we?
But sure, everywhere has them.
Oh.
Everywhere has them.
Oh, he's a ruined my morning, guys.
I love this, Mary. My friend has decided never to travel abroad again because of bedbugs. She was eaten alive by them in Spain once. So she's decided never again.
So you're dead right. There we are.
So you could go to Kerry. You could get the bedbugs in the house in Kerry or anywhere. Or
yeah, but for the bedbugs in Limerick. Kerry, we only want to talk to you about the potholes. It'd be great, old crack. It'd be fine. It'd be fine. Claire says, I'm terrified of bedbugs that I hoover my mattress once a week. The amount of people that don't hoover their mattresses is shocking.
I do hoover my mattress now. Yeah.
See, an awful lot of mattresses now aren't meant to be hoovered or turned because they've got this foam and the spring and got all of these stuff done where you're not meant to because they're meant
to kind of do it from within. But I don't mean that shouldn't stop you hoovering it, no?
But you don't have to. Like, this is genuinely...
Oh, because they can't, they wouldn't live in it. No,
there's a thing that they can't live in it, but they also have this sort of technology that prevents them from being...
Oh, let's see what an infestation... Oh, are you going to show us what an infestation looks like? No. Oh! Oh my God! All right, no. I would be moving out of the hotel.
Yeah, I think we've just turned Alan into someone who just stays in his house. This is amazing.
Oh no!
He'll never travel abroad again.
No, I will. I'll just make sure to check the mattress. Oh God, almighty!
Okay, come on, let's move. Let's not freak. Are you okay?
Yeah,
let's go. What else have we got, Shiva?
We were talking about Ireland is looking to host the Euros in 2028 along with the UK. Mm. So we're making a bid for the Euros 2028. And Peter texted in saying, "I would love to see the football in Ireland. However, I totally disagree with the GAA getting a new stadium out of the taxpayer. They have enough money to do it themselves."
It is Casement Park, so it's going to be in the north, so it's not going to be out of your tax money. You know, it's fine.
It's not going to be out. But we are going to contribute to it. If Leo Varadkar gets his way, we will contribute to it.
It will, but the UK have also said that they are going to have to pay for it as well.
Yeah. Oh, I know that. Yeah. John says, I'm all for having the Euros here, but people are going to be fleeced once again by hotels, shops and transport. And this includes our very own people.
Of course it does.
Yeah, of course it does.
Absolutely.
Because one of the quarterfinals will be held here in the Aviva if we get it, which it looks like we are going to get it. Mm. So it'll be huge. And they were saying 189 million will be created for the economy.
We should go on the website for people renting out their houses for the Ryder Cup around Limerick and Clare and North Kerry. 30 grand for a week. Oh yeah, there's this website.
In a house?
For a house.
You'd hope there's no bed bugs in them.
You never know. You'd never have a bed bug in Limerick. They'd be too afraid of the Shiva. You're mad. We're also talking about e-scooters because legislation is coming into place in October that's going to make them legal on our roads. And Mike says policing these e-scooters will be difficult with our Gardaí already under pressure. I see these scooters being used on rural roads with young people flying around. And not even a high-vis jacket weaving in a traffic, definitely going way over 20 kilometres. An hour, because that's going to be the legislation, and we all know.
That's not good.
Like, I clocked one at 45 one day.
Really?
45 going beside me. I was like, oh my God.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah. Amazing. Yeah. Thank you so much for all of your messages today. Are you going to have messages about our next item?
I think we might.
After this, we're hearing all about the power of magic, but a particular sort of magic from a witch.
Don't go anywhere. We'll see you in a few minutes.
I love when Sammy Sausages comes out to play.
Oh,
it's good
I'm
crap.
Telling you.
Welcome back to Ireland AM. It is the witching hour now as we talk magic, but a particular type of magic on the show, sex magic.
Yes, having moved from the Cayman Islands to Ireland to practice her sex magic is Billy Bryan. Good morning to you.
Good morning.
Good morning,
We've
Billy.
Been talking about this all morning, Billy. Uh-huh. So can you tell us what is sex magic?
Okay, so it's hard to really sum it up in such a short span of time, but it's essentially practicing witchcraft or magic by using your physical self, your sensual self, tapping into your spirituality, sensuality, and using all those facets of your being to, well, cast magic.
Cast magic.
Cast magic.
So would this be happening when you are in the throes of the act, or
can be?
It can be.
There's a variety of ways to practice that. You can do it by yourself, with a partner, with multiple partners. It's really just being in tune with your physical self and having a strong idea of what it is you want to manifest. Having all your faith in your intention, what you want to bring to reality.
Yeah, because you call yourself a witch.
I am a witch.
Like, and we've had this on before, like a white witch or a good witch or whatever, you know, witch. Like, when did you start to feel that, I'm a witch and I have these powers or I have these feelings?
I would say officially 2020 is come lockdown, you know, with COVID and everything. I found myself in a position where I thought I would throw myself entirely into my craft. I'm cooped up in my room, can't go anywhere. At the time, my partners had left me. They were in the U.S. So I was left to my own devices and just dabbling in it at first. Thought I'd give it a go, see what happens. And sure enough, it worked. So, and I've stuck with it ever since.
What do you mean you gave it a go? Like, just like some people think, though, I'm born with this gift or whatever. Mm. But you sort of said you sought it out.
Yeah. I think we're all born with certain gifts, right? everyone has a certain flair for music or sports or fashion, what have you, some more than others. I think my area specialty is not really sex magic, but that is something that everyone does seem to want to latch on to. But it's just, I started reading up on the occult, on mysticism, all matter of witchcraft from around the world. And I was captivated by it.
Listen, because much like someone practicing a religion, mm-hmm. Wiccan is a form of religion. And certainly in this country, there right. is a very big history and tradition Absolutely. Of people practicing paganism. Like even W.B. Yeats was big into that's all right. of that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. So it's something that you kind of learned, but you're harnessing a power that's within you. Mm-hmm. You're originally from the Cayman Islands.
That's right.
So would there be a big witching community over there, or is it something that an awful lot of people practice by themselves?
I wouldn't say we don't have much of a big community in terms of anything over there. A very small country.
Yeah.
But I think the witch community, if you want to call it that, is growing. When I was living there, we did do regular gatherings, as we called them, every 2 weeks for the new moon, the full moon. And they were slowly growing in size as, you know, lockdown ended and people were hearing more about it. And that's partly what I want to do in Ireland as well, is continue those gatherings and foster community. Maybe people will carry on the tradition and back in Cayman too.
Yeah. Is there a community here? Because I know you can, we've had plenty of witches on the show over the years.
Why you came to Ireland? Is that the reason? And especially Galway?
That's partly the reason, but I assure you, Ireland is rife with witches. They're everywhere here. Really? They're not as prominent as they are in other places in the world, but they're certainly here. But Galway especially, we wanted to set up shop with their new cafe, which I will talk about, in Dublin initially. But Galway just seems to be more home to the creative types.
Yes,
artists,
so,
musicians,
yeah.
dancers, and the like. And it's those quirky, creative deviants, we call them, that we really want to work with.
You talk about, because I'm trying to get my head around this, right? Okay. So you're saying people have kind of tagged on, they're talking to you about the sex magic, but you practice all sorts of magic.
Right.
So is this in relation, like we've heard so much about the goddess, mm-hmm. the mother, that is very central to paganism and Wiccan religion.
Right.
So is it kind of praying to her, doing chants and incantations with her, and then manifestation? Or what is it?
That's actually a good description of it, yes.
Right.
It's very much is that. I commune with her on a regular basis. Essentially
this is everything. The mother goddess.
Mother goddess, yeah.
Who is the mother goddess? Can you explain
so
that?
So for me, she's like this amalgamation of many different deities that have existed throughout human history. You've heard maybe of like Ishtar or Inanna or Isis or the Virgin Mary, for example, is another mother goddess figure. So she's, again, like a combination of all those things. I'm very attached to the divine feminine, as a lot of witches will talk about.
Yeah.
You know, we associate the feminine with the moon, for example. So, again, I like to coordinate the gatherings in tandem with the cycles of the moon, or I'll meditate on their full moon, things like that. That's just my personal, my goddess of choice, really.
Yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And what does it bring you, though? This is what I'm wondering. So you're performing mm-hmm. this sex magic.
Okay.
What do you bring forth in your life from it?
All right, well, picture this then. In 2020, when I was just getting into the craft, I had almost no money to my name at the time. Lockdown had just started, COVID was, you know, in full effect. My partners had all left, my child is off to the US. I was essentially all alone with no income, nothing to do with my life. And again, I threw myself into the craft and I started manifesting. My affirmations were abundance, balance, beauty, control. And I've been saying those every single day ever since. And months later, fat check fell in my lap with the opportunity to sell my home, fly off to Ireland, settle in over here, start a new life for myself. And I got everything I wanted, basically.
But would if that have happened, do you think, if you weren't practicing this?
I sincerely doubt that. I threw all my intent into making this life that I'm living right now happen for me. So I would hardly call it luck.
And honestly, we talk about manifestation on this show all of the time.
People are such believers in it.
Staging and doing all that kind of stuff.
Right.
But I suppose it is because you're here to talk about your cafe in Galway, which you're hoping to manifest and bring forth very soon. but I'm not performing sex magic now if I was thinking about it. Or are you able to perform sex magic right here while you're talking on the television? What does it feel like?
It'd be a very limited form of sex magic.
I would assume so. Listen, you never know what's going to happen on this show. Mm. But what does it feel like?
It's very rewarding. You feel very in tune with your physical self, spiritual self. You come out of the experience feeling restored, refreshed, empowered.
Do you reach an orgasm?
You don't, not always, you can. It's not really about the orgasm. In fact, I would say sex in general, it's not really about the orgasm all the time.
No, but I'm just saying, like, when do people think of this and they go, oh, this is going to be the most wonderful sexual experience and orgasm I've ever had? No.
It can be if it's that rewarding for you. But again, it's sex magic is not about achieving orgasm. It's about achieving your dreams, manifesting your dreams. So
how do you do it?
I was about to say. My personal process involves very much the kinds of things you might imagine yourself doing when you're being sexual with your, well, intimate with your partner. Turning down the lights, lighting some candles, burning incense, playing some really nice sensual music, and I like to fill my tub full of water and just submerge myself in it for maybe half hour to an hour and meditate. Focus entirely on what it is I want to manifest in my life, what it is I desire most. And, you know, you get into the practice, it becomes a ritual after a while. And the more you do it, the more real these things become. And sure enough, the universe delivers accordingly.
And you want to manifest a cafe in Galway. Is that happening?
It's happening.
It is happening.
It's happening.
When's it opening?
We're hoping to open sometime this month.
Oh, wow.
Fingers crossed.
Whereabouts is it?
We're right there in Eyre Square, Galway.
Oh, wow, in Eyre Square.
That's right. Right.
And it's, okay. It's for witches to gather, for all people, but also it's going to be...
Witches, creatives, yeah, really.
Beautiful. Well, we hope it goes really well. And no better month to be opening a witchcraft cafe, really, in Galway, is there? Thank you so much, Billy Bryan. People can find you online. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks very much. Very interesting.
Still to come this morning, we have got some films. We've got a comic adaptation. We've got horror. Brian Lloyd is going to be chatting all about it in just a little while for our cinema and streaming
releases. Yes, and Derek is discovering what Awfully has to offer. We're going to take a quick break. See you in a few minutes.
Hello, welcome back.
Now, lots of you have been getting in touch with us right throughout the morning. We were talking about e-scooters because they are going to be legislation e-scooters by the end of the month. And a lot of people sort of saying they're getting a bad rap. Dan says, I have an e-scooter as they are so handy for commute to work. I always use it safely and don't go too fast. I wear a helmet, a high-vis jacket when it's dark. Not everyone uses them carelessly and we're all getting a bad rap for it.
See, this is the thing. We're not like, it is bad to tar them all with the same brush, but like, we can't judge them all by the good people, you know? Yeah. Like, that's why we need legislation to make sure everyone's like a Dan, isn't it?
I think we're all saying that they're amazing for congestion for people around, because Mick says something there as well, Shiva.
Yes, Mick says, the scooters aren't the problem, it's the people riding them carelessly that are the problem. So, yes, the opposite of Dan. The second problem is that people have been let develop a few years of bad behaviour before the legislation was enacted. It's very hard to reel that in when a lot of people on them have been using them like that for a few years
That's true.
It's the same with drivers and bad habits.
I actually did try and do it and I failed before I left the driving test centre.
He keeps on bringing this up. I'm like, stop saying
that. Stop boasting about it.
Thank you so much for your messages this morning. I really appreciate it.
Now, Derek's been checking out one of our hidden heartlands this morning.
Yes, it's been wet and wild. Kind of thought through, Derek.
Oh, Tommy Gahintakar Fod Toshe Flukon Show. It is wet and wild down here in the fateful County Birr Castle domain is where we're at this morning here in County Offaly. And in fact, we put up that poll a little bit earlier on this morning asking viewers at home to answer the question, how many counties were actually in the Hidden Heartlands? And in fact, 75% of our viewers at home got it wrong because they said 9. It's actually 11. 25% of you got it right because we have the addition of parts of Limerick. And Cork, did you know that? Philip.
I did, absolutely, Derek.
Top marks for Philip. Philip, we've been here on the grounds of Birr Castle right across the Moyne, but there's so much to discover here in the Hidden Heartlands. Boora Bog, the beautiful Boora Bog. Before we get into the modern day bog itself, let's talk about the history of the bog dating back to the 1950s to the 1970s.
Absolutely. Going back to the 40s and 50s, it would have been a working bog, huge employment in the area, and then bring it on to 1977, dwelling found there, going back to the Mesolithic age, hugely important archaeological discovery. Bringing it on now, there's a huge 2,000 hectares out there of reclaimed bog, biodiversity. We've got 130 species of birds. There's fishing, there's two lakes. There's walkways, 50 kilometres of walkways and trail routes, looped routes. Huge amount of things to do with from the young fairy gardens, take a seat in the wishing well and maybe your wish will come true. The amount of engines dotted around the place for kids to play with as a nod to the industrial heritage of the site.
And it has come a long way from the 1950s. As you said, it was a big employer in the area. A lot of people would have gone through there, but now focusing on the bog into the modern area, like it's now a massive area of conservation, right?
Absolutely, and open 365 days a year. So you can spend an hour, you can spend a day, you can get lost out there, literally. But the amount of things to do is just amazing. People coming back time and time again, you will not get through it. You just have to keep rediscovering out there.
And as you mentioned, the fishermen will love it because there's two angling lakes in the heart of it.
Absolutely. And, you know, there's the cafe out there. Just the parking is free and all the... the parking is just only €5, but that's pumped back into the running of the...
And as you mentioned as well, it is wheelchair accessible, so people can get out and can explore it.
All abilities. So from the very young to the very old, you can take your time, go at your own pace, visit the sculptures. There's 20 sculptures there. Truly amazing as you walk around.
Moving on from there then, the beautiful Schlieve Blue Mountains. I think the peak of it is 527 metres. It's a gorgeous place for hiking, get out, exploring, and get out into the great outdoors, really, in October.
Get out, set yourself a base in the area, go out and explore and rediscover the whole area. The mountain bike trails there, new addition. There's family loops in Kinnity itself. Go and visit Kinnity. Find a pyramid in Kinnity.
And the loop as well.
But go and find the pyramid in Kinnity. The loops, and my favourite of all is the Glenbarrow walk. This time of the year, listening to the waterfall and echoes through the trees. It's truly amazing.
I came down here last year, Philip. I was on my mountain bike and I had a great time exploring in around the paths as well, and they're great and they're up and running, and still as we get into October, it is a fantastic place to explore.
Yeah, great. Just put the wellies in the car, put on a jacket and go out and explore this time of the year. It's brilliant. What kids truly love, just kick the leaves, splash in the puddles and get out in the open spaces.
Yeah, well, I'll tell you, we've been splashing plenty of puddles here this morning. Where can people find out more online, by the way?
Oh, visit offaly.ie, Birr Castle and Gardens, Schlieve Bloom. And Schlieve Bloom there, this walking route, there's walkings planned every weekend up there with the Schlieve Bloom Walking Club. There's so much to do in the area.
All right, so no excuse to get out and about and explore the great outdoors. Anyway, thank you so much for joining us here this morning. Remember, it's 11 counties now, right?
11, absolutely.
Not 9. It's 11 counties in the Hidden Heartlands. But for now, back to you guys in studio.
Thank you so much, Derek.
You love it down there, don't you?
I really do, yes.
She was telling us all the places to go.
I was, and my mother-in-law is probably watching. I love Birr. It's amazing. I've done my bit this morning.
There you go.
It's totally fine. Up next, our movie maestro, Brian Lloyd, is talking football legends and the evolution of the Blackberry, everybody. He's going to be telling us what to watch this weekend.
Yes, see you in a few minutes, guys. You're very welcome back. Now, with the evenings getting darker and the days getting colder, it's the perfect time to take a trip to the cinema or just snuggle up on the couch.
Entertainment.ie's Brian Lloyd joins us for what you should be watching in the cinemas or streaming or on the telly. Brian, it's lovely to have you here.
How you doing?
We're going to kick off, first of all, with a movie. There's so many movies recently about corporate things.
Yeah.
The latest one is about the Blackberry. Is it called Blackberry?
Yeah, it's just literally called Blackberry.
Blackberry.
You would think that's kind of unimaginative and stuff like that, just with a name like Blackberry. But yeah, no, so this basically follows the rise and fall of the BlackBerry company. They were called Research and Motion. What's interesting about this is that it kind of takes, I mean, it takes in the entire story, but it turns it into a bit more of a morality tale. The idea of that they basically got too big for their boots, that the greed essentially was their own downfall. And then, of course, when the iPhone came along, they were kind of kaput, you know?
It was very interesting. Let's take a quick look at BlackBerry.
Yeah, what can I do for you?
Okay, picture a cell phone and an email machine all in one thing. There is a free wireless internet signal all across North America and nobody has figured out how to use it. It's like the Force. Sorry, have you seen Star Wars?
No.
That guy is sketchy.
I don't think he's sketchy.
The guy's a shark.
I know how to market it, and I know who we can sell it to. But I want 50% of the company, and I've got to be CEO.
I don't know who you think you are, but
deal.
Are you joking?
Sorry. We were dancing to that, the soundtrack.
I know, yeah. Fantastic soundtrack.
Amazing.
Fantastic soundtrack.
So tell us more about this, because obviously this is just about a phone, and next thing we're going into greed, corporate America, and someone from who is always studying in Philadelphia being very bold.
Yeah, Glenn Howerton. Yeah, he plays Jim Balsillie is his name. Which is just a terrific name.
Fantastic.
Yeah, fantastic name. He's brilliant in this. I would say Glenn Howerton actually is, like, you know, he's the biggest name in this film, and he has the biggest performance in it, because the character that he's playing, you know, he's running around screaming at all the technicians, and he's calling them dorks and nerds and, like, cursing their faces and all that kind of stuff. Yeah, very, just totally want to spend a long trip with him. But then, like, you have Jay Baruchel, who people would know from This Is the End and stuff like that as well. He plays the actual one of the creators of the BlackBerry. Like I said, soundtrack is brilliant. They actually do get the period details quite, like, they get it very, very well, because it's set in the 90s, late 90s and everything. I really enjoyed this.
Great. So is this going to be happening more and more? Because it's interesting you say it's a morality tale. Like, like Wall Street in the 80s. We never learn greed, money is God, all that kind of stuff. Are we going to get more? Because we've had Air about Nike. We've had the founder about McDonald's. Mm-hmm. This is about BlackBerry. Yeah. We've had a Tetris.
Yeah.
There were things like Dope Sick, the Elizabeth Holmes tale, you know, this kind of stuff.
I think a lot of it has to do with the fact that, like, it's high drama, you know, that's sort of, and then there is sort of the familiarity as well. Like, people remember BlackBerry. People, you know, everyone knows McDonald's, everyone knows Tetris. Gotcha. So it's kind of like finding out the story behind it, I think.
What are you giving it out of five?
Four out of five. This is really, really worth watching.
Dying to see it. Yeah. Okay, on to the next one. Scary movie. What do we have for Halloween?
The Exorcist Believer. And the only thing that's scary about this is how crap it is.
Oh.
Sorry.
Do we have a clip to take first before he destroys it? Do we?
No? Do we not?
Maybe we don't have a clip.
It's really bad.
So tell us what it's about.
Yeah, so this is basically kind of like a soft remake of the 1973 horror classic.
Kind of like a remake.
They call it a soft remake, where it's basically, it's the exact same story as the first one, which is two kids go missing, they return, and then they're acting very, very strange. Parents can't figure out what's going on, and then they somehow then kind of find Ellen Burstyn, who wrote this book on her daughter's exorcism and all the rest of it. She gets roped into it as well. They start to believe that their daughters are possessed, and then they have to have a big finale that's kind of like an Avengers finale.
Is there
some parts of it that are very, very scary, and I would say, like, for the first 45 minutes of it, it's a very effective domestic drama. But then that was the thing that made the original one so good, was that it did have a layer of believability about it. Like, you know, that kind of, they did really kind of try to, you know, explore every single possibility for why Reagan was like this before it gets to, you know, actually, no, she's possessed.
Yeah.
And to do the same thing here as well. And even the fact that it's set in, like, you know, modern times and all the rest of it, we have access to the internet, we have access to other cultures, there's awareness of other cultures and stuff like that.
What are you giving it?
2 out of 5.
Do you think people should just watch the original?
Yes.
Okay. There we go. The original still does it.
Just watch the original.
We're going to move on to something at streaming.
Yeah. Yeah.
And this isn't called, it's called Beckham. It's not the Beckhams, it's Beckham.
It is Beckham. But both Beckhams are in it.
Yes.
Yes.
This leads me to believe that there's something coming with Victoria or the Spice Girls, to be honest.
Probably, yeah, I would say so. I mean, I'd be more interested to see the Spice Girls documentary behind the scenes thing than I would, like, you know, this. And it's not just because I don't like football or anything.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let's take a look.
Yeah, you're dying for this one, aren't you? You're very
Victoria,
excited.
Okay. I love her. Let's take a look at Beckham.
I never really did well at school because all I ever wanted to do was play football.
My manager kept saying, try and keep it under wraps. So we would meet in car parks, and that's not as seedy as it sounds.
Classy.
I suppose that most blokes have looked at the television, so they're like, don't end up with them.
Life had become something different.
We were worried that he'd lose all what he'd worked for, because football come first, and all of a sudden it wasn't.
Okay, David, big smile.
It definitely didn't change me.
Well, it changed. There's no doubt about that.
Nicely put together there.
So, two huge stars, but how much do they lift the lid?
To a point. To a point. Like, I mean, you definitely do get a wider sense of why David Beckham is the way he is. Like, there's a scene in the second episode where his father comes in and talks about how basically the father was just this complete pedantic, just was constantly training him, constantly criticizing him, do better, do better, do better. Now, obviously, that led to him being one of the most famous sports people in the world and all the rest of it. So you're kind of thinking, hey, maybe he had a point. But then there's another part of it where you kind of think, maybe does David Beckham resent football itself? Like, but it never gets that far into it. You know, that's, I was watching and I thought, does he actually kind of maybe hate football now or something like that? Does he, it's weird. I don't know. Maybe I'm just reading too much into it.
Because he's bought a football club. He's bought Miami.
I know, but like it's that thing of like it's given him this life and all the rest of it, but you kind of get the sense of like it came at a great, terrible cost.
Yes.
Because he was one of the first sports celebrities.
Yeah.
And like, you know, they covered this in The Last Dance as well, where, you know, you had Dennis Rodman being chased by paparazzi. It's the same with this as well. Yes, it's candid. To go back to your original point, it's very candid, but it's very candid. They're telling exactly the story that they want to tell. They're not telling anything beyond that. Like, even when they address, like, you know, the affair, that the alleged affair that he had and all the rest of it, they're just telling their version of
the
story.
And they don't use the affair.
No.
But Simon Fuller has always maintained, like, them as a perfect family, and this is PR as well. I'm looking forward to it. What would you give it?
3 out of 5.
3 out of 5. It's on Netflix. Yeah. It's out now. And very quickly, let's talk about Loki season 2.
Loki season 2, yes. So this is the first time that a post-Netflix Marvel TV show has got a second season. Tom Hiddleston is back. Owen Wilson is back in the cast as well. K-Hu Kwan, who people will remember from Everything Everywhere All at Once, he joins the cast as well. He's brilliant in it. Mm-hmm. This is basically like a very high-budget version of Doctor Who. So if you like the first one, you're going to enjoy this.
Okay.
You're kind of, you're aghast there, like Doctor Who. Do you like Doctor Who?
Who? No, well, kind of.
Kind of.
But if you like the first one, you're going to get something else here. Because
yeah,
Marvel
definitely
haven't had an awful lot of success, bar WandaVision maybe, in this
Yeah,
realm.
This is it. Like, Secret Invasion was pretty pants. And, you know, Falcon and Winter Soldier was okay.
Yeah.
Hawkeye didn't really go anywhere. But Loki was the big one that everyone likes, so yeah.
Great. Fabulous. That is on Disney Plus. Brian Lloyd from entertainment.ie. Thank you so
Thank
much.
You.
Cheers. Cheers. That's all we've got time for this morning. What's coming up tomorrow, Alan?
Well, great show tomorrow. He starred in some of the biggest movies of all time, including The Mummy, Mamma Mia 2, and Sex and the City. Funny man Omid Djalili joins us for a chat.
The tattooist of Auschwitz author Heather Morris tells us about her gripping new novel.
And we're going to be showing you how to create and maintain the perfect eyebrows.
You have them
you
always.
Don't
Look
need
at
it.
The
you
perfect, perfect eyebrows here. Join the team tomorrow from 7. We'll see you back here next week. Have
bye.
A great weekend. Bye-bye.